Today we're going to be taking a look at the new Pi-Man 5 Max case for the Raspberry Pi 5. It's designed by Sun Founder as an update to their last case, and it now features dual NVMe support, a black aluminium body, and tinted acrylic panels. The standard kit alone costs $95, which is on the high end for a Pi case, but it does have quite a lot to offer. One of their marketed features is that you can run a Halo AI accelerator alongside an NVMe SSD. So it should be great for AI tasks like onboard voice recognition, object detection, or pose estimation. This is their third generation of Pi-Man case, and it looks a lot like its predecessor. Visually, it changes from a silver and clear acrylic design to black with tinted acrylic. You'll also be able to see the dual M.2 ports for NVMe drives, and it's got some other improvements like programmable RGB lighting and a tap-to-wake OLED display. So let's get the case assembled around a Pi 5 and try it out. The case comes in a white branded box. Inside that is the aluminium shell packed full of components, including the fans, cooler, expansion boards and mounting hardware. Like with the previous case, there is quite a bit to the assembly process, so it takes more than a couple of minutes to put it together. They include a graphical instruction sheet, and the screws are all quite well identified, so it's not difficult to do. To assemble the case, you start out by adding a few different length standoffs to one of the enclosure halves. You then plug some carrier boards into the Pi and mount the Pi assembly into the case. The Ice Cube cooler goes on next. Cooling pads go into the CPU, Wi-Fi adapter and power circuitry. The cooler uses the same mounting points as the active cooler, so those just press into place. Next, you install the dual NVMe adapter. The NVMe adapter supports multiple drive sizes from 2230 through to 2280. I'm going to install the Halo AI accelerator in the top port. And then I'm going to be using a Lexar 2280 size drive, which I'll install in the bottom port. We then attach the fans to the back panel. If you're using a camera module, they tell you to install that now. I'm going to add one eventually, but I'll rather add that later once I've tried the case out without it. With that done, we can plug in the GPIO expansion board with the OLED display. Then screw the two aluminium case halves together and stick the display onto the front panel. The tinted acrylic panels then finish it off. The power button's mounted to the front panel before installing it. Lastly, we need to stick the silicon feet onto the bottom. Assembly was relatively easy. The step-by-step illustrated instruction sheet is good, and all the parts fit together without any issues. They also give you quite a few spare screws and cables in case you need them. All up, it took me around 25 minutes to have the case assembled and ready to boot up. To boot it up, since I've already installed Raspberry Pi OS onto the NVMe drive, we just need to plug in the power cable. On first boot, nothing's going to show up on the display. To get that and the RGB lighting to work, we'll need to install some additional software. This is a simple config change and GitHub install that took a few minutes, and I didn't have any issues working through their wiki. They claim to have tested it on a number of Pi 5 compatible operating systems, so you can still use the display, fans and lighting features if you're using Home Assistant, Ubuntu or Kali Linux. When the installation script completes the install, you'll need to reboot the Pi. Once you're back on the desktop, the LED lighting and OLED display will start up. The display shows the CPU usage and temperature, the Pi's IP address, as well as the RAM and storage capacity. The display automatically goes to sleep after 10 seconds, and can be tapped to wake it back up again. You can also change the timeout in the script settings. One of the features that I liked on the last case, and that I'm glad they've kept, is a really useful web dashboard. This is accessible through the browser by going to your Pi's IP address along with port 34001. Through this dashboard, you can see your system stats, plot graphs of the stats, see logs, and modify the case script settings. It's even got some customization options for the display, like choosing which driver network interface to display, or to flip the display if you're using it in the case upside down. You can also change the color of the RGB lighting and adjust its style and animation speed. There are controls for the two RGB fans and a few modes based on whether you'd like them to be quiet or better at cooling. This is also an improvement over the last case, which didn't have PWM fans, so they were either off or on at full speed. I'm interested to see how these perform in performance mode in comparison to the previous generation case, which had some cooling restrictions. I'm also interested in how loud they are in the two extremes of their modes. So first up, let's try a thermal stress test. I'm going to set the fans to always on to give the case the maximum amount of cooling. I'm then going to use CPU burn to apply a full load to the CPU, and I'll leave this running for about 30 minutes to see what temperature it stabilizes at. At the stock CPU frequency of 2.4 GHz, at idle, the CPU temperature started at 35 degrees. After the 30-minute stress test, the temperature stabilized at 46 degrees. So we've got a delta of about 11 degrees, which is really good. This means that you've got quite a lot of headroom for overclocking. For comparison, on the previous Pineman case with the same Pi and NVMe drive, we get a similar starting temperature of 36 degrees, and this goes up to 53 degrees under full load for 30 minutes. So we have a delta of about 17 degrees. While this isn't that bad, it's higher than you'd expect for a case with three 40mm fans on a single Pi 5. In my video of that case, I thought this was largely due to there being inadequate air inlets and unnecessarily restrictive dust filters on the exhausts. This Pineman case does much better than the previous generation because they've added some air inlet vents to the front in the form of the Pineman name, and they've removed the filters from the fans on the back. I then tested the sound level. With the fans set to quiet and with no load on the CPU, none of the fans are running. The ambient sound level is around 29 to 33 decibels. Switching them to always on and under a full CPU load, the fan noise is around 47 decibels. So it's quite a bit louder. This would be annoying if you had it next to you on a desk, so it's great that they have the quiet and balanced fan options. To test the NVMe drive speed, I'm using James Chambers' Pi benchmark script. This script favors random read-write performance, so it's a good representation of how an OS uses the drive. Over three consecutive tests, I got an average score of 37,333. This is as expected for an NVMe drive running at Gen 2 speeds on a single lane interface. The Pi defaults to Gen 2, but you can change it up to Gen 3 by editing the config file. Next, I tried the Halo AI accelerator with a connected Raspberry Pi camera module, and I used the example sets of pre-trained models from Halo's developer zone. Using the AI accelerator, we can do a lot more onboard processing, allowing us to do things like real-time pose estimation and object detection. Pose estimation works really well with the onboard camera. It runs at 30fps and the Pi CPU stays at just 15%. You could use this type of interface to control software or to drive output devices like servers. Object detection is also quite cool to play around with. This again only uses around 15% of the Pi CPU, while processing 30 frames per second. You can also do person and face tracking, which will also work with multiple people in frame as well. Overall, I think the Pineman 5 Max case looks really cool. I really like the new dark color scheme. It also provides some great features, and it fixes the noise and cooling issues that I found on the previous case. I particularly like the dual NVMe slots, which allow multiple drives or devices to be used, and the fact that all of the cables run out the back of the case rather than on the back and side. I also like that it's got full-size HDMI ports, so I don't have to deal with the micro HDMI port on the Pi. In terms of size, this case is the same size as the previous generation, measuring 112 by 117 by 79mm wide, and they've obviously crammed a few more features into the available space. SunFounder have again tried to make the best case that they can for the Raspberry Pi 5, and they've done a good job at it. It comes with quite a high price tag, but in terms of value for money, it is fairly good. You can pick this kit up and you don't need to worry about getting a separate cooler, a dual NVMe hat, fans, or an OLED display. If I had to pick out something to be critical about, I think they could do more with the PWM control on the back fans. It would be great if they gradually ramp up at increasing CPU temperature, rather than just turn on or off at a set point. Let me know what you think of the Pioneer 5 Max case in the comments section below. I'll leave a link to it in the video description if you'd like to get your own. Thanks for watching. Please remember to like this video if you enjoyed it, and subscribe for more tech and electronics projects, tutorials, and reviews.